Raconteurs Audio, in association with Spoken Realms, present Mrs. Dalloway by Virginia Woolf, read by Helen Lloyd. From Cymbeline by William Shakespeare. Fear no more the heat of the sun, nor the furious winter's rages. Thou thy worldly task hast done, home art gone, and ta'en thy wages. Golden lads and girls all must, as chimney sweepers, come to dust. 1. Mrs. Dalloway said she would buy the flowers herself, for Lucy had her work cut out for her. The doors would be taken off their hinges, Rumpelmeyer's men were coming. And then, thought Clarissa Dalloway, what a morning, fresh, as if issued to children on a beach. What a lark, what a plunge, for so it had always seemed to her, when with a little squeak of the hinges, which she could hear now, she had burst open the French windows and plunged at Boughton into the open air. How fresh, how calm, stiller than this, of course, the air was in the early morning. Like the flap of a wave, the kiss of a wave, chill and sharp, and yet, for a girl of 18 as she then was, solemn, feeling as she did, standing there at the open window, that something awful was about to happen, looking at the flowers, at the trees, with the smoke winding off them, and the rooks rising, falling, standing and looking, until Peter Walsh said, musing among the vegetables, "Was that it? I prefer men to cauliflowers. Was that it?" He must have said it at breakfast one morning when she'd gone out onto the terrace. Peter Walsh. He would be back from India one of these days, June or July, she forgot which, for his letters were awfully dull. It was his sayings one remembered. His eyes, his pocket knife, his smile, his grumpiness, and when millions of things had utterly vanished, how strange it was. A few sayings, like this, about cabbages. She stiffened a little on the curb, waiting for Dirtnell's van to pass. A charming woman, Scrope Purvis thought her, knowing her, as one does know people who live next door to one in Westminster. A touch of the bird about her, of the jay, blue-green, light, vivacious, though she was over 50 and grown very white since her illness. There she perched, never seeing him, waiting to cross, very upright. For having lived in Westminster, how many years now, over 20, one feels, even in the midst of the traffic, or waking at night, Clarissa was positive, a particular hush or solemnity, an indescribable pause, a suspense. But that might be her heart, affected, they said, by influenza, before Big Ben strikes. There. Out it boomed. First a warning, musical, then the hour, irrevocable. The leaden circles dissolved in the air. Such fools we are, she thought, crossing Victoria Street, for heaven only knows why one loves it so, how one sees it so, makes it up, building it round one, tumbling it, creating it every moment afresh. But the veriest frumps, the most dejected of miseries sitting on doorsteps, drink their downfall, do the same. Can't be dealt with, she felt positive, by acts of Parliament, for that very reason. They love life. In people's eyes, in the swing, tramp and trudge, in the bellow and the uproar, the carriages, motorcars, omnibuses, vans, sandwich men shuffling and swinging, brass bands, barrel organs, in the triumph and the jingle and the strange high singing of some aeroplane overhead was what she loved. Life. London. This moment of June. For it was the middle of June. The war was over, except for someone like Mrs. Foxcroft at the embassy last night, eating her heart out because that nice boy was killed, and now the old manor house must go to a cousin. Or Lady Bexborough, who opened a bazaar, they said, with the telegram in her hand, John, her favourite, killed. But it was over, thank heaven, over. It was June. The King and Queen were at the palace, and everywhere, though it was still so early, there was a beating, a stirring of galloping ponies, tapping of cricket bats, Lords, Ascot, Ranelagh, and all the rest of it, wrapped in the soft...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.